thanks very much for coming. I appreciate it. I always try to make sure that the cable is here because I know for a lot of folks, many of the folks who most need to see this can't come get out of the house because they're taking care of somebody or because they can't get out. So we try to make sure it goes on cable. Hi. It's funny, I feel like I've done 1,000 of these and I still panic before every one. I'm like, oh. That's why I never watch myself on these. I never watch these on TV because I keep saying, maybe I'm going to find I'm really boring and I won't be able to do it anymore. It should be really terrible. Okay. Do you need a handout?
Yeah.
Here you go.
There may be quite a few more people coming.
Okay.
That banquet just got
up. Oh, oh, oh. What was the banquet at the fairgrounds?
Senior Man and Woman of the Year.
Oops. I guess I scheduled wrong.
It should have been over, but still there.
Right. Oh, well. Okay. By the way, does anyone know? So I took the occasion this time. We brought my wife. Right? We were actually in Martha's Vineyard yesterday. We flew over today. And we walked the Syosconset path, the cliff path. When did that show up? That's such a wonderful, do you know how long ago that was created? That was,
1915.
Yeah?
Forever.
Like forever. Just, it was, that's not a recent thing.
Because
I didn't know. I didn't know whether that was, you know, I'm saying to myself, was this a big subdivision? And the developer said, well, we'll keep the access for everybody along the road. But then somebody mentioned to me, actually, that was a gift. It was actually, it was a bequest of that path. It's just so good. So are we good? We're good. Okay. Hi, and thank you all for coming to my presentation today, and thank you very much to the Nantucket Senior Center, to the Saltmarsh for inviting me. My name is Arthur Bergeron, for those of you who haven't met me. I'm an attorney at Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us. Somebody there does just about everything. I do nothing but elder law and have been doing that for a number of years. So the reason why I try to do these presentations is to try to, a lot of elder law, it isn't like there's one particular thing that you have to know. There are a bunch of like little things and how programs come together and what programs you might be eligible for and who you need to contact. So there's a whole bunch of different pieces to this. And so that's why I try to bring them all together. Now, in my first presentation in Elder Law 101, which we did about 2 months ago, I went over kind of the things that you need to know when you're slowing down. So what is it about wills and trusts and healthcare proxies and power of attorneys and what kinds of documents and a whole bunch of stuff. Elder Law 102 is really understanding, well, we're going to talk a lot about benefits, but we're going to talk specifically about things that benefit you to protect your house. We're going to talk about my friends Frank and Mary, my make-believe couple, and their children Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. And you've heard this before. They have a very simple goals in life. They want to die and be buried in the backyard. When one of them dies, all things considered, they'd like to leave everything to the other one. When the two of them have died, they want to leave everything to the kids. And they hope that they don't run out of money before they die and that there's something to leave to the kids. And that's kind of their general goal. So their assets are not substantial, but okay. They have a house that's worth $300,000. They obviously don't live in Nantucket, right? He has an IRA worth about $170,000. And by the way, we're going to talk about some of the issues, because we're going to talk a lot about the house, some of the issues that are unique to the Nantucket house and how it affects these numbers. They have an annuity worth $100,000. They got a small bank account. They've got total assets of $650,000. Frank's got income from Social Security of $1,500 a month and from a pension of $5,000. And Mary has income from Social Security of $750 a month, they're going to do okay. Unless they have major medical problems, they're going to be okay. But as I mentioned, their real goal is to stay in the house, and to stay in the house until they die. So I want to start off by talking about, so how could they do that? And there were really two pieces to that. One, what can they do to save the house itself? And then what can they do to take care of themselves while they're in the house so that ideally they can continue to be there? So the big thing about the house, as I always tell my clients, is I get the fact that you want to stay in your house until you die, except if you want to do that, you may have to be changing your house to some extent, right? Because your house, that house with the bedrooms on the second floor and with the kind of, you know, no handicapped accessibility and the steps and the kitchen that maybe you can't really get to, especially if you've got a walker or if you've got other issues, these are things that may very well need to be modified. And if you really want to stay in your house, which is a great goal, you need to figure out what that's going to cost and how to pay for it. And there were actually three programs to help you stay in your house, and I'm going to talk about all of them, and they're all different forms of a reverse mortgage. And I know as soon as I say the word reverse mortgage, people just die. They go, oh, no, I'll never want a reverse mortgage. Doesn't that a lien on my house? Yes. Isn't I going to have to get paid off someday? Yes. And therefore, you wouldn't do it if you didn't have to do it, right? And I never suggest reverse mortgages for people who are retiring and are just trying to pull out equity in the house in order to kind of maintain their lifestyle at 65. Because, you know, it's a long time between 65 and when you die now. Remember when Social Security was created, life expectancy was 65. No longer the case. But on the other hand, if your goal is to stay in the house and you want to figure out how to stay in the house, and you don't have, as Frank and Mary, don't have a lot of other cash, and I know I've spoken to folks here on Nantucket who are in this kind of situation. They have a very valuable house, but not a huge pile of money, and they want to make sure that if they need the money is going to be there. So maybe they don't want to use the money to take care of the house. So there are three things you can do. One is the home modification program. You probably didn't know about this. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts will actually loan you $30,000, up to $30,000, to fix up your house. And the interest will either be very low, like 3%, or zero. There are no monthly payments, and the mortgage is only due when you sell your house or when you die, which sounds a lot, you know, like a reverse mortgage. That's actually how reverse mortgages work. Now, so the question then is, so what is it that constitutes low income versus no income? And the answer is, if you're Frank and Mary and you're living at home by yourselves, then your income to be low income for their purposes, you have to make less than $78,800 a month. Well, that's not like really, really low. That happens to be about double Frank and Mary's income. So if you make less than that amount, then you are entitled to that loan at 0% interest. 0% interest. If to be entitled for the loan at all, at 3% interest, you have to have income of less than $157,600 a year, right? I'm sorry, did I say a month before? Yeah, that wasn't right. Right. So to be low income, you have to have income of less than $78,800 a year. You know, I've been on Nantucket all day. You know, you start losing it after a while, right? But anybody else can get it for up to 3% interest by earning less than $157,600 a year. Now, $30,000 isn't a huge amount of money, but to be doing the kinds of modifications we're talking about, unless you're putting in an elevator or doing some dramatic thing, that's not a bad deal. Second, of course, there are traditional reverse mortgages. Reverse mortgages are available to people who are 62 years of age or older. The amount that you will be loaned is based on two things. It's based on your age and the value of the house. Basically, the reverse mortgage companies will say that they will give you or loan you until you die a percentage of the value of your house. But that percentage gets higher the older you get, because the older you get, the more likely it is that they're going to get paid back fairly quickly, right? Now, there is a cap on this amount, and that cap is around $650,000. So even if you've got one of those houses that you bought, you know, 20 years ago for $200,000, and oh my God, it's worth a million something now, right? The way that this formula will be worked out will be based on about $650,000 and no more. And then you get a percentage of that money. Now, if you're Frank and Mary and you own a $300,000 house, then, and you're 70 years old, and they're both 70 years old, the amount they would get would be about $167,772. They could get $103,000 of that right away. They'd ultimately get $167,000. So they would be able to get a little more than 50% of the value of the house. If they were both 80, or if the younger one was 80, it's always based on the age of the younger of the two if both are applying, then they would be able to get up to $192,000, or a little over 60% of the value of the house. So once again, if your house were, just double these numbers, if your house were about $600,000, then you'd be able to get about $320,000 if you were 70, and about $380,000 if you were 80, which is, in terms of the value of the houses around here, that's not a lot. But in terms of how much you need to live for the rest of your life, that wouldn't be a bad supplement. This would have been about $4,000 to close the deal. And what I tell people on these is what you want to do. What you don't want to do is do one of these reverse mortgages and simply pull all the money out. Because then, if you're trying to keep the debt on your house down, because then the debt, the monthly interest payment that gets deferred and added to the principal, is on the entire amount that you just pulled out. But if you're Frank and Mary, and you're simply doing this because you want to do some repairs on the house, and they're going to cost you $50,000, then you do the reverse mortgage. You take out the $50,000 plus the $4,000 that it's going to cost you to close. You take out $54,000. Now, the monthly increase in the amount that is owed on the house is only based on that $54,000. It's not based on the entire amount. So you can really keep the amount lower. One other thing I'll mention about these, it is assumed by people that it is inevitable that your mortgage amount, if you do a reverse mortgage, will increase. That's actually not the case. You always have the option, if you're pulling a reverse mortgage out, to pay the monthly payment, which is going to be this interest rate, which right now, by the way, the interest rate, this date is 30 days old. The interest rates right now are about 3.7%, right? You can always pay the monthly payment, in which case the amount that's owed on your house will not grow because you're paying the monthly payment. And this, by the way, leads me to the final question that I always get about reverse mortgages, which is, so why don't I just go to the bank and get a line of credit? Because I could, you know, because banks will typically give you a line of credit, not based on your current income, but based on the value of your property. And my answer is always, well, except that if the choice is to get a line of credit or to get a reverse mortgage, and if you pay the line of credit payment every month or the reverse mortgage payment every month, the same thing happens. But if you don't pay the line of credit payment one month, you get it foreclosed on, whereas if you don't pay the reverse mortgage payment, you're okay because that's kind of built in. So which one do you pick, you know? And I get it that that the closing costs on a straight line of credit loan are lower than they would be on a reverse mortgage. And so you may decide that that's where you want to go. But if, you know, for my friends Frank and Mary, and for most of my clients, and you may have heard me say this before, you know, you get to be a certain age and the goal of life is to sleep well at night. You know, I mean, it's no longer fame and fortune and all this other stuff. You just want to be able to sleep. So the nice thing about the reverse mortgage is you never have to be worried that even if there's a financial crisis or this or that, that the payment's not going to get made. You just don't have to worry about it. So that's the reverse mortgage. Finally, the town will give you a reverse mortgage on your house equal to all of your real estate taxes. Maybe folks didn't know about this, but so if you are 62 years of age or older, once again, if both spouses are, then you can go to town hall and you can say, I don't want to pay my taxes anymore, right? And they'll say, well, no, but you have to. You say, well, no, I don't want to pay them anymore. I want to sign the little thing that says that I don't have to pay them until I die. And that's what the deal is. There is a special state statute. For those of you who are legal trivia people, right, it is General Laws Chapter 59, Section 5, Clause 41, Capital A, that's the section, that says that every community must allow you, if you are over 62, to defer all of your taxes, some or all. If you want to, you can pay some of them. But whatever you don't want to pay, you can defer. If you are entitled to any exemptions like the residential exemption, or an exemption because you are old, or because you are otherwise old, or because you are a veteran. You can take all those. But whatever's left, whatever you got left to pay in taxes, you can defer, right? Now, the state says that there are two rules regarding that deferral. One is that your income can't be higher than $20,000 a year. That's not very much. And two is that your interest rate that they charge you is 8%. But the state says the community can vary this, can vote to vary this. So I stopped at your assessor's office this morning, and because I couldn't find anything on your website about this, and I was like, oh, maybe they don't do it here, because I know that in most of the communities at the other island on Martha's Vineyard, they do it. So I was kind of surprised that they haven't done it. So actually, the person in your assessor's office said that, yes, they have increased the income limit to $70,000 annual income. So if your annual income is less than $70,000, 70, you can defer all of your taxes until you die, right? And the interest rate that gets charged is not 8%, but 4%. The community has the right to actually reduce the interest to zero if they want. I know a few communities that have done that. So for those of you who are in that situation, not uncommon around here, that you have an asset that you know used to be worth a little bit and now is worth this gigantic amount of money, but you love it, but as a result, one of your biggest bills annually is your real estate tax bill, right? Well, even if you won't believe me about reverse mortgages and you've got enough cash put aside that you feel comfortable, if you feel like it, you can just defer all your taxes, right? Until you die or until you sell the house. It's a reverse mortgage being given to you by the town and the county of Nantucket. Okay, so that's what we just talked about that. Oh, and I will go back to that, though. One other thing, you can do the tax deferral at the same time that you do a reverse mortgage. You can do both. And the reason for that is, while in most states, a company giving you a reverse mortgage would not allow you to enter into this kind of agreement with the town, because in most states, the real estate tax is a so-called super lien. It's a super priority lien. Even if you have a mortgage, like right now, if you have a mortgage on your house and you don't pay your taxes and the town goes to take your house for taxes, their taking takes priority over your mortgage, even if the mortgage was signed by you 5 or 6 years before you owed the taxes. It's called a super priority lien. But Massachusetts, which is, in my opinion, based on, I do a lot of this work with folks from a lot of parts of the country, the best state to be in if you are older, right? In Massachusetts, and in one other state, I think, they've actually passed the statute dealing with a tax deferral specifically says that the lien for the deferral is junior to or comes behind a reverse mortgage. It takes priority over all other kinds of mortgages, but it comes behind a reverse mortgage. And the reason why they did that was so that reverse mortgage companies would allow you, even though you have a reverse mortgage, to also defer your taxes, okay? So that's all about taxes. And once again, Nantucket, incredibly generous in terms of this income number. That's typically the problem my clients find with this item, is that their income is too high because the state number is so low. So now, excuse me, a few things about staying in your house. So you've got a wonderful house and you fix it up and you're not having to pay the taxes and that's all great. But if you need it, if your health is deteriorating, if you need home care, how do you find a way to stay in your house? And the first answer to how you find the way is call Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands. I've mentioned this before, but I'm going to mention it again. Basically, the state is divided into 27 areas. They're called ASAPs, Aging Services Access Points. And for Cape Cod and the Islands, this is your Aging Services Access Point. They can tell you every benefit program, and they want to tell you every benefit program that you are eligible for. Their goal is not to try to keep you from receiving benefits. Their goal is to get you to have benefits. So the first thing you want to do is talk to them about what kinds of programs are available. These entities were created through, we're all old enough to remember LBJ, Lyndon Johnson, who created the Older Americans Act. Remember Meals on Wheels? Everybody knows Meals on Wheels. That's when they got created. They actually administer Meals on Wheels. They're the people through whom all of the money flows. So they do Lifeline, they do Meals on Wheels, they do advice on all other kinds of benefits. I'm just going to talk about just a couple of them. Their basic benefit, which is called BASIC, that wasn't very creative, I know. And then their other benefit called ECOP, and I still don't remember what ECOP stands for, but it's ECOP, E-C-O-P. And these are both programs designed to provide home care benefits to you to help pay for a home care person if you need to have a home care person in your home. And the thing to remember about both of these programs is that there is no asset test. And I want to emphasize that because so many people are used to dealing with mass health and mass health benefits, and we're going to talk about those for a few minutes, but you're used to that, and therefore, and because mass health does have very stringent asset tests, people assume that you can't qualify for stuff because you've got too much in assets, especially for folks who live here because they think, oh, I got a house, I'll never qualify. Well, there's no asset test. Now, here's the chart. See, this is like an eye test, right? I can hardly see this chart from here, but you see it on your handout. What they do have is they require a copay. They require a copay from you, depending on what your income is. But I want to give you a sense of the value of this. In the copay, by the way, if you are Frank and Mary and you're making around $30,000 a year, the copay is, I think it's $107 a month, right? Now, what the benefit is, if you get on BASIC, if you're on BASIC, then the ASAP, Elder Services, will pay for as much as approximately 6 hours of home care per week. And this does not have to be home care like, you know, you need help getting out of bed, you know, or you need help like eating. This can literally be home care like making you a meal, you know, or going out and doing the shopping because it's today and it's Nantucket and you can't get out of your house, you know, like trying to drive around. So it can be a lot of different things. So it's 6 hours a week. And through ECOP, if you can demonstrate that you have more need for help, it can be up to 12 hours a week. Or 12 times 4.3 weeks in a month is around 50 hours. Now, the number that I have heard here for what it costs to actually buy home care here was around $25 to $30 an hour, right? If that's right, at $30 an hour, 50 hours would be $1,500 a month. If it's only $25 an hour, it's only $1,250 a month. So your copay is $107 a month, right? So this is a very, very, very valuable benefit to you, right? Which you ought to consider. And the way that you find out whether you're eligible is you don't have to convince them that you're eligible. You just have to call them. Call them. They'll have a phone call talk to you about what your situation is. And then they'll probably send somebody out to your house just to figure out if you're eligible. You know, I really like this program, and it's like your tax dollars at work. You know, you pay for this. This is your state tax money and federal tax money paying for these programs. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the frail elder waiver also, if you're Frank and Mary, because if you really want to stay home, even if you've gotten very sick, you can stay home if you're Frank and Mary in this particular situation, right? But first, you need to be able to show MassHealth. MassHealth is the Massachusetts name for Medicaid, and MassHealth is a means-tested program. There is an asset test as well as an income test for MassHealth. But first, to qualify for MassHealth is most known because it pays for nursing home care. It's the government entity, the government program that pays for nursing homes. Medicare, which you all have, at least most of you, it's everybody over 60, anybody over 65 here? Oh, look, that's a lot. So Medicare will pay for your nursing home care. They'll pay for our island home, but not for more than 100 days of our island home, and only if you came from a hospital after a 3-day stay, because Medicare only pays for the cost of getting better, not the cost of staying the same. If you're no longer getting better, or in any case, after 100 days, you're off Medicare and need to qualify for MassHealth. If you do qualify for MassHealth, though, MassHealth will also qualify you for a program to keep you at home, because MassHealth's preference, even if you need nursing home care or otherwise qualify for it, is to have you at home. Why? Because it's cheaper for them. You're doing it because you want to be at home. They're doing it because it's cheaper. Now, so you need to know what it is that qualifies you medically for nursing home care. To qualify for nursing home care, You need to require assistance with at least two of the ADLs, activities of daily living, which I know you'd say, well, that's everything, activities of daily living, right? The things you do in your day. Well, but there's five magic ones, and if you need physical help with two of them, not necessarily every day, but on occasion, then you are medically eligible for nursing home care. They are bathing, dressing, eating, toileting, transferring. Transferring is getting up out of a chair, walking across the room, sitting down. That's transferring. If you need assistance with two of those, or if you need supervision, if you need constant supervision because otherwise you may be at risk, typically because you have dementia from some form. If you need those, then you are medically eligible for nursing home care, even though you'd never want to go, and even though actually you could probably kind of manage at home, especially if you're Frank and Mary and one of you is kind of okay. You're medically eligible, though. And if you are, then you are also medically eligible for the Frail Elder Waiver. I'm going to talk about that program a little bit more in a second. Finally, I'm just going to mention this briefly. If you are a veteran, or if your spouse was a veteran, or if you're widowed and your spouse who has died was a veteran, if they were in active military service for at least 90 days, and one of those days was during a period of war, then you are also eligible for a very big home care benefit of up to $1,500 a month. I'm just mentioning this because many people who are kind of in our age or older, and therefore either served in World War II or in Korea, don't realize that those wars lasted a lot longer than they may have thought. So World War II, for their purposes, ended December 31st, 1946, even though the bomb got dropped in Hiroshima in like August of 1945. The Korea ended January 31st of 1955. I just had a person who was astonished to find out that he was actually qualified for this benefit because he started his service in late 1954, and he thought Korea had ended about 2 years before. The fighting had all kind of stopped. So there is a benefit. If you want to talk to me, if you have interest in that benefit, we don't do a lot of that. There are folks that just focus on this benefit. We'll be glad to refer you to someone. We're going to talk about that in a second. The Frail Elder Waiver benefit that you can get if you are Frank and Mary, a couple more things on the veterans benefit. There is a myth that you cannot qualify for the veterans benefit if you have more than $80,000 in assets. That is a myth. Actually, you can qualify depending on an evaluation by the VA of how much money you need in order to live for the rest of your life, right? To the extent that you have more than $80,000 in assets, you can often restructure those assets in order to cause you to have less than $80,000 in assets. And I'd be glad to talk to my veterans person about this, but it is my understanding that while there is a proposal to impose a look-back period in this program, that is not yet passed. That is my understanding. And that benefit, when you're at home, if you're Frank and you need the benefit, is up to $1,644 a month. And if you're married, because Frank has deceased, it's up to $880 a month. Now, we're going to go back to MassHealth for a few minutes. So I talked to you a little bit about becoming medically eligible for MassHealth. So suppose you are Frank and Mary, and those are your numbers, and Mary needs nursing home care, or is at least eligible to receive nursing home care because she needs assistance with two of the activities of daily living, or she needs constant supervision. In that case, even given those assets, Mary can qualify immediately for the Frail Elder Waiver. The reason for that is while there is an income test, the income test only applies to her while she and he are both at home. The income test is she has to make less than $2,199 per month. She makes only $750 a month, so she qualifies. Incidentally, Frank would also qualify because his income is only $2,000 a month, but we're just talking about Mary. So Mary could qualify income-wise. There is also an asset test, and the asset test is that Mary has to have less than $2,000 in countable assets to qualify for the Frail Elder Waiver. Frank, though, can have infinite assets. Frank can add infinite assets. So they can be here in Martha's Vineyard with a $1 million house and a little bit of savings. She can want to stay at home. As long as she's medically eligible, she can shift everything to Frank. Shift the house, shift all the money, and the next day she'll qualify for the Frail Elder Waiver. What does that get her? It gets her as many hours of care a week as Elder Services decides that she needs. MassHealth will pay for. There is no technical limit to the number of hours that MassHealth will pay for. Typically, their plan will not be for more than 40 to 50 hours, right? But I've seen plans that are higher than that, so it's a very, very valuable benefit. I'm just going to check and see what that one. Okay. I'm going to also talk a little bit about nursing homes here, because if Mary then needed to go to a nursing home, then she still, Mary could qualify for MassHealth. The reason for that is, if she were in a nursing home, her assets have to be less than $2,000. Frank can own the home no matter what the value. No matter what the value. So Mary can shift her house to Frank, even in Nantucket, right? And the house is still safe. Now, Frank would still, in this case, have too much in assets, because remember he had assets of about $300,000. But what he could do is he could buy an annuity in that case in order to cause his asset pile to go down. The rule is, as long as you are buying an annuity, as long as Frank is buying an annuity that calls for monthly payments over a term that is shorter than Frank's actuarial life expectancy, and if Frank were 80 years old, his life expectancy would be about 8 years. As long as it's less than his life expectancy, the purchase of an annuity in any amount is a legitimate conversion from an asset to income. So that even though Frank can only have $119,000, $220 for Mary to qualify for MassHealth, Frank can convert his asset pile to an income pile and thereby qualify her for MassHealth. The only thing that Frank and Mary would need to do, or that I would recommend that they do in this situation, is, let me put it this way. Remember going back to the beginning of our presentation, Frank and Mary's goal was, and it's very typical, when one dies, they want to make sure that the other one inherits everything, right? Well, if that occurred here, and if Frank died and Mary inherited everything, and Mary then need to qualify either for the frail elder waiver or to be in the nursing home, she'd be in big trouble. Because remember, Mary can only have $2,000 in countable assets. So if she inherits everything from Frank, she then has to spend down all of her money. At that point, MassHealth will put a lien on her house. And following her death, MassHealth will recapture that house. There's something even worse than that regarding Nantucket, but we're going to talk about that in a second. So Frank and Mary could avoid that problem, though, by very simply making sure that each of their wills says that when I die, everything that was going to go to my wife, instead of going to my wife, it's going to go in trust for the benefit of my wife. Frank could leave everything in trust for Mary's benefit. He could name one or more of his children as the trustee for her benefit. If he died, those trustees would have the discretion to use some or all of that money for Mary's benefit. But if she needed to qualify for MassHealth, none of that money would be countable. The house would not be countable. She could qualify for MassHealth, and there'd be no lien on any of the assets, right? Related to the earlier presentation that I did here, to Elder Law 101, though, one of the things you want to make sure of is that you always have a power of attorney. The most important document you can all have, documents, are powers of attorney and healthcare proxies. You'd want to make sure in this situation, if Mary were incapacitated and were needing to shift assets to Frank, right? That somebody had Mary's power of attorney so that they had the ability to shift the assets to Frank, because if she was incapable of doing so, she'd be stuck. But the only problem here is, or the big problem, and I'll talk about it a little bit, because inevitably people will come up to me after my presentation and say, you always talk about Frank and Mary. I'm just Mary. Frank's dead already. What do I do now, right? So I'm going to talk, and that's more of a difficult problem, because in that case, if Mary needs to go to a nursing home, what would normally happen, as long as her house were worth less than $828,000, is that she'd be required to spend, if she were at our island home, she'd need to spend down all of her cash, and then MassHealth would put a lien on the house, and following her death, MassHealth would collect on that lien to get reimbursed for whatever they had paid. The extra problem, though, in Martha's Vineyard is, say Mary bought that house in the early 90s for a couple hundred thousand dollars. So this is a case for a couple hundred thousand dollars, but now it's worth $1.6 million, right? Because why? Because it's Nantucket, right? So suppose Mary's house were worth $1 million. and she needed to go to a nursing home. Well, her problem there is that because it's worth more than $878,000, she has to sell the house. She has to spend down her cash, and then she has to sell the house because the house is a countable asset. The house is a countable asset, right? And therefore, she has to sell it. Once she sells it, or when she sells it, unless she was living in it for two of the previous 5 years, and even then, she's going to still have to pay a big capital gains tax. If she had bought a house for $200,000 and were selling the house for $1 million, unless she had been there for two of the previous 5 years, her capital gain on that house would be $800,000 and her tax would be about $200,000. If she'd been there for two of the last 5 years living in it, then the capital gain would go down to about $500,000, right? But there'd still be a big tax. So she'd have to pay the tax and then take the rest of the money and use it at the nursing home, right? It's like everything is bad about this situation, especially if you're here, especially if, and you've got one of these houses that is worth a lot of money. So what she really needs to do, if you're married, she needs to transfer some interest in this house out of her name. She probably, what she wants to do, in the simplest situation, if Mary's got a couple of kids, or in the simplest situation, one child, and so she knows there aren't going to be any arguments, one of the things she can do is transfer the house to that child and keep a so-called remainder interest in the house, or excuse me, keep a so-called life estate in the house. She transfers to her child a remainder interest, that is, everything about the house after she dies, all the ownership in the house after she dies, but she keeps a life estate, that is, total control of the house as long as she's alive. Now, if she does that, and if 5 years goes by, because, and that's the five-year look-back period that you've always heard of, the famous five-year look-back period. At the end of that five-year look-back period, the remainder interest that she has transferred to her child or children is no longer a countable asset by MassHealth. So if she goes into the nursing home, MassHealth, first of all, can't count that asset, so it doesn't throw her assets off, and they can't lien that asset, right? They can lien her life estate still, but at the time of her death, her interest in the house, her life estate, evaporates. And therefore, so does the lien. So does the lien. So if she transfers the house to her kids and keeps a life estate, and 5 years go by, the house, the remainder interest is safe. The only thing that can be liened is the life estate. If during her lifetime that house gets sold, MassHealth is going to want a piece of the proceeds equal to the value of the life estate. So another piece of the plan is don't sell the house, right? You don't want to sell the house. But the point is the house is sold. The only time that this would not work in Martha's Vineyard, or excuse me, in Nantucket. Well, I was in Martha's Vineyard yesterday. I know it's the other island. You know, I'm not supposed to even say the word, you know, but sometimes I get mixed up. So the only time this would be a problem is for people whose properties have really gone up a lot. So that the life estate itself would be worth more than $878,000. Now, if you want a kind of a rule of thumb in terms of figuring out what your life estate is worth, if you're 80 years old, your life estate's worth, at this point, your life estate's worth about 20% of the value of the house. Okay? So $878,000, I keep saying it, $828,000, $828,000, that's the magic MassHealth number. If you multiply that times 5, it would be about $4 million. So your house would have to be worth about $4 million for the life estate value to go over the magic number. In other words, probably most of your houses are safe if you just transfer the house and keep a life estate. The only time you wouldn't want to do that, right? Well, first of all, you wouldn't want to do that if you really, really, really don't trust your kids, you know, and you're concerned that later on in your life, for some reason, you may want to sell your house and therefore kind of rearrange things, right? And you're afraid that they won't want to help you out. And I'll give you an example from the other island of that exact thing. That exact thing. I was talking to someone last month, is an older couple, that was trying to protect their house for MassHealth purposes. And so about 20 years ago, they transferred the house to their kids. They transferred a remainder interest in their kids. They kept a life estate. Now they are in their mid-80s. And for various other reasons, can't afford to live in Martha's Vineyard anymore, and therefore want to sell their house. They want to cash out, and they want to move back to Boston. They're from Boston. which would be great, except they had four kids. Three of them are willing to transfer their remainder interests back to the parents so the parents can sell the house. One won't. One won't. There is absolutely nothing they can do, right, to force that child to convey his remainder interest back, right? They are stuck. They're just, there's nothing they can do. They're just so stuck. They can't take a reverse mortgage out either, by the way, unless all the kids sign off on it, right? So that's one possible concern. Always, that's like the worst, you know, everybody's worst nightmare is that kind of thing happening. The other is if the kids themselves, if you're concerned that after your death, that the kids themselves that might disagree regarding what to do with the house, right? And that's certainly not an uncommon situation. And I know it's not an uncommon situation here. Because as opposed to most places in the universe where if you're, you know, you die and what's going to happen to your property? Well, your kids are going to sell the house and take all the money and divide it by the kids. Except who wants to sell a house in Nantucket? You know, or I was going to say that other island name again. Who wants to sell a house in Nantucket? Because the kids have come to visit, right? They all love it here, right? And the grandchildren have been here. They don't want to sell, or at least they don't all want to sell. Like the one in San Francisco who never comes out, well, he wants to sell, right? But the one who's like lives in Boston, he doesn't want to sell, right? So what if you think there may be those kinds of disagreements? Well, in that case, what you may want to do, and only in that case, would be to create an irrevocable trust. Instead of just transferring the property to your children and keeping a life estate, create a trust, which is irrevocable, which means as far as MassHealth is concerned, you can't get the property back. But in that trust, you set up some rules regarding what happens to your property after you die. Maybe you make your kids the trustees. You create some mechanism that says either this is how the property gets managed, or if you don't all agree within like 90 days of the day I die, it's going to get sold and the proceeds distributed. I always call that the nuclear option, you know? So you just, you know, it's fine. Maybe they will all agree, but if they don't, at least you know it's not just going to sit around. I have a feeling when I was walking on Syosconset today on that cliff walk, I saw a house that looked a lot like one of those. One of those that looks like it's just sitting, right? And there's something, you know, you look at one of those, you go, oh, there's something wrong there, you know? And I have a feeling that that's what's going on. So that's when you would do that. And in either of those cases, you have to wait 5 years. Finally, one other thing. In general, and people have heard me do these presentations before, I don't recommend long-term care insurance for people because it really doesn't pay the cost of long-term care. I mean, the cost of buying a policy that will pay the cost of being in our island home for 5 years, right, is pretty big because being in our island home for 5 years costs you about $750,000. So buying a policy that will cover that is very expensive. On the other hand, there is this one little MassHealth provision, right, that says that if you own a long-term care insurance policy that will pay for $125 per day of care in a nursing home for at least 2 years, right? And that's all it has to do, $125 a day for 2 years, and it's still in effect at the time you go to the nursing home, then MassHealth cannot require you sell your house, cannot put a lien on the house, and following your death can't collect anything against you, right? So if you can get one of these, right, and if you're over 70 years old, you probably can't, right? But if you can, and you live here, get that policy because there is no cap on the value of the house. That can be a $5 million house. And if you have that little dinky policy, right, and you go to the nursing home for however long, there will never be a lien on your house, right? A couple of other things about this. If you already have one of those policies, here's a caveat for you. If you already have the policy and the policy was dated before 2013, then if it has one of those provisions, which many of these do, that says that you can use the policy for home care, many of these policies, you can use them, you'll get a daily rate that they're willing to pay you, and typically they'll allow you to use up to that amount per day to finance home care. Well, if you use your policy for that, such that at the time you go to the nursing home, there's less than 2 years worth of days left on that policy, then you've now lost this benefit, right? So if you bought a 2-year policy, like this minimum policy, And then you forgot to tell your kids this, and you got dementia, and so they used the policy for home care for like one day, and then you went to the nursing home. The house was no longer safe. So this is a classic trap for the unwary. You want to be aware of that. If your policy was dated after 2013, this is no longer a problem. The state legislature, responding to a lot of lobbying, among others from a group I belong to, the Elder Lawyers Association, who were saying, this is just a trap. This is awful, right? They changed the law. So that today, regarding that two-year policy, almost the opposite is true. Not only is it not true that you could lose it if you just, you know, were off by a day, but you can actually, if you have a two-year policy, this two-year policy, and it has a home care option, and you actually use the home care up, as long as there's at least one day left on the policy when you go to the nursing home, it protects your house, right? So it's really, those little policies are just terrific right now. One final thing for those of us who are so old that it's actually possible that you had a really old policy. If your policy is dated prior to April 15th, 1999, and you still have a policy, as long as the daily benefit is at least $50, not $125, $50, your house is safe, no matter how much the value of your house. I just had this happen. I had a couple came in, and the husband's mother had exhausted her other assets. She had nothing but her condo. She just went into the nursing home, and they were figuring, well, you know, at least we won't have to sell it, and it'll be, you know, we'll end up having to pay on the lien. But I said, well, actually, do you have any long-term care insurance? She said, yeah, but it was this little nothing policy. It's like worth $60 a day. I said, how old is it? She said, well, what difference does that make? Well, I said, how old is it, right? She said, so she actually pulled it out, and it was like 1998. I said, let me make your day. It's one of those great moments as a lawyer. You know, it's like, let me make your day. The quarter of a million condo that you thought you had lost, you've just gotten back again. You know, congratulations. So anyway, if you can get one of those little policies, get them. Get that policy. Finally, if you found this so interesting that you're dying to see it again and you don't catch it on Nantucket Cable, and thank you very much to Nantucket Cable for being here today to broadcast these. Frank and Mary have their own website, their YouTube channel. It's called Elder Law Frank and Mary, and you can watch this and any of their other productions. And remember, the goal of all of this is to sleep well at night. I hope that this has helped some of you think about some of these issues and maybe sleep better. Or sleep worse because you know you have to go talk to somebody, but at least you know. Now you know. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any questions from anybody? Yes, ma'am.
I have a nursing home policy.
Yes.
But if I became, can I qualify for Mass Health and have somebody come and not use the policy?
If you have, your question is, you have a long-term care insurance policy, and your question is, can you qualify for MassHealth and not use the policy?
Right.
No, you can qualify for MassHealth, but if you qualify for MassHealth, MassHealth will require that you use your policy and they'll pay for everything else.
Oh, I think I meant, do I qualify for elder care, not MassHealth?
So is your question, do you qualify for the other home care programs that I was talking about? Well, see, MassHealth will typically pay for that. MassHealth will I understand. So, if you have a long-term care policy that has home care in it, right, and you don't feel like going to MassHealth, right, you can always just use the home care policy. Is that answering the question? No.
No, I don't want to use my long-term nursing.
You don't want to use your you
I don't want to use,
ah. If you can't if you I understand. There were two different kinds of benefits that I talked about today. One was MassHealth, right? Which was the federal. It's federal and state program, and to do that, you have to be asset qualified. Blah blah blah. Before that, though, I talked about two other programs that are available through the state, actually funded with state dollars, basic and ECOP, and they will pay for between 6 and 12 hours worth of home care for you at home, right? So if your question is, will they pay for that home care for you at home even though you have a long-term care insurance policy?
Yes.
The answer is, call them. Of course, that's the easy thing, right? Call them. But I believe that the answer is yes. I believe that you'll qualify for that program as long as you're in, you know, paid the deductible, regardless of what your other long-term care policy says. So you can use that program and then use your policy to like buy additional care in addition to that. So I think you can get both. It's a very, very good program. Once again, it's Massachusetts is a great place to be old in, you know, in many ways. Yeah, it's very interesting. Yes, sir.
You were talking about reverse mortgages.
Yes.
Earlier, you have a current mortgage.
Yeah.
You get a reverse mortgage and pay off the current mortgage. That way, you have the protection of not having to pay, etc. And when you die, do your heirs have to pay off the reverse mortgage, or can they, like a regular mortgage, carry it forward?
Okay. So the first question is, can you use the reverse mortgage device to actually pay off your existing mortgage? Absolutely. And that's one of the most common reasons I'll tell people to do it, right? People will come to me, they'll say, once again, somebody came in and said they were dying because they couldn't survive on their income, and they had Social Security and stuff. But they're, you know, and they had a pension, and their total income was not bad. It was like $40,000 a year. And I was like, I'm sorry, I'm having trouble understanding why this isn't enough money, right? Well, they said, well, gee, our mortgage payment is $1,200 a month. I said, $1,200 a month? And it was because it was like a 30-year mortgage. They had 5 years left on the mortgage, but they were still paying the big payment. You know, they didn't have that much total. So it was a perfect case for a reverse mortgage, right? Where the reverse mortgage came in, the amount that was left on that old mortgage was like $50,000, right? So it got rid of that. As it happened, she didn't need any more money, right? Because getting rid of the old mortgage basically increased her income by $1,200 a month because it got rid of that payment, right? So that's very common. And so that was such an interesting presentation. I forgot the second question. What was the second question? I'm losing it. And if you have that reverse mortgage.
Oh, yeah. You have.
Okay.
So
there's really two questions. So the answer is if you have done what I talked to you about with Frank and Mary, and you have transferred the house to your kids and kept a life estate, you can then still get a reverse mortgage. The kids are going to have to sign. They don't become liable in any way, but they all have to sign. Reverse mortgages companies, however, will not accept a reverse mortgage if you have put the property in trust and kept a life estate. Only if the owners of the remainder interest are individuals, not trustees of a trust or corporations. So that is one of the disincentives for using the irrevocable trust as a mechanism for protecting your house. You thereby lose your ability to do a reverse mortgage. And the final question was, I'm going to use that your other example, whether or not you gave a remainder interest to your kids. When you die, what do the kids have to do about the reverse mortgage? And the answer is they have to pay it. They have to pay it within a year. The mortgage is due and payable within a year of the day you leave the house to go to a nursing home to do something, or within a year of the day that you die, or immediately on sale.
What's your liability if one of your kids gets into financial problems, gets sued for something? Is there any look back that they can come after a chunk of the house?
The question is, what is your liability if your kids get sued for something? And you got to give me you got to go back to which example I'm using. If you have given this, this is a second issue with doing just transferring a property to the kids and keeping a life estate. So you do that interest that is owned by the kids at that point, the remainder interest, is a real estate interest. It only shows up in the future after you die. But it's real and therefore can be attached. So if your child has a creditor, that creditor can attach that interest. And if your child has a spouse and there's a divorce, there's trouble. I actually had that case also, right? I had the mother who was saying, I don't have a problem, do I? Right? My son just got served with papers by the wife, and she had done this transfer. In this case, unfortunately, he's the only son, or he's the only child. So he's got the remainder interest, and now that's going to be in play in the wife's in that divorce.
Can you make their name under trust restrictive that it does not bleed out beyond
Yes, that is one of the reasons why people will do, that's another reason why people might do a trust versus just doing a deed to the children with keeping the life estate. If you're deeding it to the trustee of a trust, right, for the, even if it's for the benefit of those kids, the common device that I use in those cases is I'll do the trust, say there are three kids or four kids or whatever, or even two, right? I'll name more than one child as the trustee, right? And say that both trustees have to agree in order for there to be a distribution to anybody. So that's, so say I've got Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. here, right? And I say my trustees are going to be all of them, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr., all three, for the benefit of Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. Except the rule of the trust is that no distribution can be made to any one child without the vote of at least two of the trustees, which means that if any one of them gets sued, that no one of them individually can require a distribution out. That means that no creditor can force that distribution, and no disgruntled spouse can put that distribution in play. So it's a way of protecting it. So there are those kinds. So there is a point at which, God forbid, I have to say, you got to go talk to your lawyer. I know it's a terrible thing. I'm never supposed to say that. Any other questions? If not, I'm glad to take questions afterwards. Thank you very much for coming. Have a wonderful summer. We'll see you in the fall. Thank you.